Brothers and sisters, praise the Lord. I would like to welcome you wherever you are or wherever you are watching us from. As I bring to you our today's message from Kawangware Methodist Church, my name is Reverend James Mureke, and I'm a forgiven sinner. I would like us to share together from the book of Paul's letter to Ephesians, chapter 4, verse 22 to 32. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 to 32. Let us pray before we read the word. Our God and our Father, we come before thy presence tonight as we appreciate your love and your mercies upon each one of us. Thank you, Lord, for gathering us wherever we are watching from as we prepare our hearts to hear from you this evening. Lord, use me as a vessel to share the oracles of your kingdom with your children this evening. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. I'm reading from New International Version. You who were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your own self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Verse 25, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. You has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Verse 32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. The word of God to his people this evening. Our theme tonight is living as new creation, or living as a new man. Today, I would like us to discuss or to share some of the aspects of things that have become part of life by sanitizing them, but they hinder us from having a good and a strong fellowship with our Maker. From the letter that we have just read, if you read the the first three chapters of this letter of Ephesians, Paul, you will see that Paul has written about God's eternal purpose. That is verse 11 of chapter 3. And also about the one new man, the church, which God has established. Verse 15 of chapter 2. And he also has talked about our calling to be God's children. That is verse 5 of chapter 1 of Ephesians. And also in the other part, the last three chapters, Paul writes about how we should live our daily lives. Since we have been called to be God's children, we need to know how God's children should act. Because if we are God's children, we must act like God's children. No mix-up should be detected in our midst or in us. The same chapter that we have read, verse 2 to 16, Paul reminds us that we have been called to be one new people, members of one family, and that is the Church of Christ. Now from verse 22 that you have just read, Paul reminds the Ephesians that they had come to know Christ as Savior, and now they needed to learn to live life the way he taught them to live. Believers need to be taught to follow the way of Jesus if they are to be truly his followers or his disciples. It is like putting on new clothes. They must put off the garment of the old life and be ready to put on the new garment of Christ. That's what we read in verse 24. Our thoughts, our attitudes, and our deeds are controlled by our minds, and thus it is important that a new mind created in Christ Jesus replaces that deceitful old mind that corrupted us. Paul in Romans chapter 12 verse 2 says, as I quote, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is good, pleasing, and perfect will." However, we do not achieve this new self simply by trying hard to be different. It is a new creation as a result of the work of Christ on the cross. This new self to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. This was our original position before the fall in the Garden of Eden. Paul discusses in verse 25 that one specific aspect of the old self that must be put off so that a new self can be put on. And the first aspect or the first thing to be put off is falsehood or lying, which must be replaced by speaking truthfully to one's neighbors. We must speak the truth always, in every situation. It doesn't matter the danger that you may be in, but speak the truth, and the same truth will set you free. It is not enough simply to refrain from lying, but we must speak the whole truth. When we withhold part of truth, we often lead others to believe a falsehood, even though we have not actually lied. We deceive others by adding part of the truth. Many of the prisoners that we have flogged in our prisons today found themselves behind the bars because someone somewhere gave a false witness or lied before the court. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16 to 19, that there are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue is the second one, the third one is hands that shed innocent blood, the fourth one is the heart that devises wicked schemes, the fifth one is the feet that are quick to rush into evil, and the sixth one is a false witness who pours out lies, pours, kumwaga uongo, bila kusitasita. Such a person survives through lies. Kwake kulala ni uongo, kuamuka ni uongo, kula ni uongo, kuamuka ni uongo. Kila kitu kwake, for him to survive, ni uongo. Ndio wale wanaita, nipatie, nikuambie. And the seventh one is a man who stirs up dissension among brothers. We need to speak the truth always. We need to keep our word, our promises. There must be trust between us, and the foundation of trust is speaking one's word. Many families, brethren, have been destroyed by a lying tongue. Though it is a small part of the body, as James states in chapter 3, verse 5, many business partners have separated due to lack of trust, which is mostly caused by a lying tongue. Children have disagreed with their parents because of lies. Why have I overemphasized on this matter of falsehood? It is because lies or falsehood has caused a big damage within the society. The second thing to be put off is anger. Paul says that in your anger do not sin. This is a quotation from Psalm chapter 4, verse 4a, which says, as I quote, in your anger do not sin. Anger is sometimes justified, but brooding on anger and being preoccupied by it is sinful. If somebody has offended you, you must forgive him or her. We must forgive the offender, not be angry with him or her. We must hate the sin, but love the sinner. That's how Christ treated us. We must not drag out our anger for a long time. It must end by the time the sun goes down, so that the Satan will not find an opportunity to enter our hearts and turn it into a sinful anger. It is only by forgiving our offenders that we will end our anger. The devil is always looking for an opportunity to use our anger for his purposes. Another example of old behavior that Paul gives us is stealing. And the new behavior that he wants us to embrace is work. Work. Doing something useful. It is not enough just to give up stealing, but one must begin to work. There is no room for laziness. We must work, not only to provide for our families, but also to provide for others who are in need. You need to eat from your own self. Stealing is not only breaking into other people's houses or by force or robbery with violence, but also stealing from public coffers, public money, or public land is also stealing, and you have no space in the kingdom of God. That example of old self that Paul talks about is an awesome thought, and the new behavior is the thought that is helpful for building others up according to their needs. Let everything we say be judged by this standard. Does it help build others up, encourage them, or benefit them in some way? If so, then let us say it. But if not, then let us keep silence. There are some people whose thoughts are full of destruction, even destroying other people's character without apparent reason. The other thing is gossip and slander, which must be replaced by speech that is helpful and building others up still, but not destroying them. The other example is old behavior is very broad, that is grieving the Holy Spirit according to verse 30. It says, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Brethren, whenever we sin, we grieve the Spirit of God, who was given to us as our helper. The Spirit is grieved by every kind of unholiness and everything that is we do which is not pleasing before God. The Holy Spirit does the work of spiritual transformation or change in us, leading us to put off the thoughts and deeds of the old self and put on those of the new self. Whenever we grieve the Spirit draws away from us. Whenever we Christians grow lukewarm in our spiritual lives, whenever our zeal or joy increases, it is almost always because we have grieved the Holy Spirit in some way. You can read Isaiah chapter 63, verse 10. Remember, we have been stamped with the seal of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. Even though the Spirit has sealed us for the day of redemption, that redemption has to be consummated. The Holy Spirit seal is our passport to heaven. Let us not lose it. Consequently, we must avoid bitterness. Bitterness has caused a lot of damage in our community, in our families, in general. Many of the deaths that we are witnessing in our society today are caused by bitterness and anger. A man becomes bitter and decides to murder his wife or children, and then he takes his own life. Also, tribal clashes, kidnappings, all these are caused by bitterness, and we need to avoid it. We need to avoid rage. We need to avoid anger. We need to avoid madness. That will lead to such things as brawling, slander, and other forms of unwholesome thoughts and behavior. These vices must be replaced by the virtues of kindness, compassion, and forgiveness. Because we have been forgiven of God by God, as believers, we have to forgive one another. we no longer have any right to withhold forgiveness from our fellow brothers and sisters. We are not about to be tender-heartedly approachable as the Lord has shown himself to be to us. As I conclude, just as God has acted with grace toward us, so must we, imitating God, act with grace towards others. Just as Christ loved us, so we must love others. Christ gave himself up for us as an offering and a sacrifice to God. Likewise, dear ones, we must give ourselves up for others and present our lives and our bodies as an offering and a sacrifice before God. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for the counsel that you have given us this evening. We thank you, Lord, for reminding us about the life that you have been living here or now. And reminding us that, Lord, we need to put off our own self and put on our new self, so that, Lord, we may live a life worthy of your calling here on earth. So that, Lord, we may be able to be examples to others who have not encountered with you. Your word reminds us that, Lord, we need to be imitators of Christ. Because the moment, Lord, we imitate you, we will be able to grow near others, so that, Father, you may be in the same fold under the same shepherd, that is Jesus Christ. Father, remember my viewers, our members, and other brethren, wherever they are. Father, may you continue blessing them as they continue, Father, to seek your face. Don't hide your face from them. Let them continue experiencing your love in their lives, even as they continue to serve you. Father, we remember those who are in different needs. Lord, may you meet with their needs according to thy riches in glory. Let them celebrate your mighty acts in their lives as they enjoy what, Lord, you have purposed to do in their lives. Those who are unwell, wherever they are in different sick bays, Father, may you visit them and touch their health, touch their bodies, and restore their strength in their bodies, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. There are others who are suffering at their homes. They have nobody to take care of them. They have nobody, Lord, to take care of them medically. Father, we pray for your divine intervention. Father, so that, Lord, you may touch them. You may restore their hope in their lives. You may restore their strength in their bodies, in their lives, in the mighty name of Jesus. And let them know that, Lord, you live it, and you will always fulfill your promises to your children, because you are our Lord. Let them know that, Lord, through your stripes, they are healed tonight. We thank you and we praise you. Bless our country, Kenya. Especially at this moment, Lord, that, Father, we are in experiencing this evil pandemic of COVID-19. Father, we see the numbers going up of the infected people. Father, we pray for your divine intervention, knowing that, Father, you are our great physician. Father, continue healing us. Continue healing your people. Continue healing our economy. Heal each one of us, because we are experiencing this heat of COVID-19. That's why many have no jobs, others, Lord, have lost everything because of this virus. Father, we pray that, Lord, you may restore hope to your children. Restore hope in our families. Restore hope in our working places. Thank you, Lord, for this fire you brought us. Continue blessing us, continue binding us together because of love that cannot be broken. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. May the Lord bless you. Amen.